Good evening, friends. In the seventh lecture of the constitutional law series, we shall look at two issues, the issues of the right to freedom of religion, which actually is worded very interestingly in the constitution as the freedom of conscience. And we shall also look at cultural and educational rights. These will cover articles 25 to 28 insofar as freedom of religion is concerned, and Article 29 and 30 as far as cultural and educational rights are concerned. We have circulated to you the Constituent Assembly debates of Articles 25 to 28 and then Article 29 and Article 30. We have taken it out from the Constituent Assembly debates. We apologize that we sent it to you only today. We should have sent it to you a couple of days back so that you could read it. But the intention of sharing with you these Constituent Assembly debates is so that you have very easy access to very seminal documents which actually shape the way our constitution got formulated. We feel it's important that all of us citizens, at least those of us who can read and write and who are interested in knowing about contemporary affairs, should read the debates, because the debates are a very rich source of information, as also gives you ideas about what went behind the constitution shaping. We have shared these debates with you so that you can read it at your leisure at a later point in time. And we will urge you to read them at some point in time, as it is an enriching experience by itself. We have also shared with you two other documents. It sort of broadly gives you an idea about the right to freedom of religion in terms of various case laws, so that you get an idea about the type of cases that have gone up to the various courts in India related to religious freedom rights. With that backdrop, we shall now start the discussion today in terms of Article 25. We need to be clear in our mind that, as we have been repeatedly telling you, the Constitution was written in the backdrop of partition and the bloodbath that followed. So Article 25 to 28 actually contains a core, along with Article 5 to 12, which is on citizenship. These two sets are very core to what issues led to the division of India and Pakistan. So the issues of that period were the issues of religion, which actually divided people and which created immense misery, terrible violence, and perhaps more number of people died in the partition than in the Second World War. So it's important for us to therefore understand what went behind it, because the issues that we are now going to discuss are issues which were attacked even at that period, to say, why is it that we need to bring religion into the constitution? What is the purpose in giving religion rights? Particularly the recognition of the right to propagate would lead to a situation where certain proselytizing religions will use this, particularly Christian and Islamic religion, to convert more people to their fold. And therefore, this right should not be recognized. There was another set of issues that had come about, which were discussed at that point in time, which also talked about need to recognize the ancient culture of India, and that at the heart of it, India is predominantly or a majority Hindu country, and therefore we should recognize Hindu religion if at all we need to recognize religion. Underlying both is the recognition that the constitution makers and bulk of the leaders at that time had accepted that India should be a secular state, and India should avowedly keep aside the whole issue of India being a Hindu theocratic state. All this requires repeating, particularly because they are the issues on which the last 6 months politics in India has been played out, starting with the CAA protests and the amendments brought to the Citizenship Amendment Act and the various things that followed, right up till today, where the people protesting the CAA alone have been targeted for arrest. And the records say that about 1,200 people have been arrested for the Delhi incidents. Bulk of the people who have been arrested appear to be people who are protesting against the CAA, and ministers of the present government and other politicians who openly gave calls and incitement to violence are going scot-free, and nothing has happened to them. It is in this context that when you look back at the debates, that you understand what went on behind and the sagacity and the maturity of our leaders of that period. And you wonder where that maturity has gone in terms of today's leaders. It particularly stands out when you come, when you look at the debates that went, that preceded the whole right to freedom of religion, particularly when they talk about freedom of conscience. And then you ask a question, why did they frame it as freedom of conscience and not just religion? I'll come back to that in a short period. There are other issues, as I've already talked to you about, was the right of practice, profession, and propagation, that it should not be there. You had a wide variety of views in the Constituent Assembly. You had some Muslim leaders who said, change all the names. Let's pass a law to change all names so that no caste appellation, no community appellation is used to identify people. In a future secular India, we are all secular citizens. Let's have a new set of names without anybody figuring out your caste or community based on the name. I'm just giving you as an example of the type of issues that came up before the Constituent Assembly when the debate on Article 25 took place. You will find this in the document that we had sent you. You had people like Katie Shah, who talked about in such a sensitive manner about the whole thing, who said, let's, in secular India, people should have the right to profess and to propagate, but let us also call upon them that this right to propagate should not be a right to propagate in educational institutions where young minds are there, where these institutions are taking aid from the government. He was very, very sensitive and very, very cautious when talking about it, saying, please do not misunderstand me when I'm saying this, because I think that we are right in recognizing the right to religion, but there are some aspects to religion, to religious rights that we need to be conscious about, and he talked about it. You had people like Loknath Mishra, who characterized Article 25 as a charter for Hindu enslavement. Very strong words. A charter for Hindu enslavement. He talked about Article 25, it was Article 19 in the draft constitution, saying it's one of the most disgraceful articles and it's the blackest part of the draft constitution. He talked about it as a secular device to bypass the ancient culture of the land. This is the type of opinion that he pointed out. Ghanshyam Gupta talked about the freedom of conscience, that a man is either free to have a religion or to have no religion. You can have, you can follow any religion that exists in India and equally have a right not to profess a religion. And there was a comparison made between Buddhism, Jainism and other religions. There the issue of faith came in and said, Buddhism and Jainism reject God. That does not make them less religious. It's an issue of faith. And therefore, he talked about the fact that there should be freedom to follow any practice. You had H.V. Kamath, who talked about the fact that we are not just in India, but outside in the entire world, a war-weary, war-torn world, where the values of the spirit are at its lowest ebb. He talked about the necessity of a set of spiritual values that should imbibe the future India. Very similar to the issue of constitutional morality that Ambedkar talked about during the on the day when he presented the draft constitution to the Constituent Assembly. You all may remember it from our discussion in the first lecture and the second lecture. You also had Durgabai, who talked about the fact that opening of temples has taken place because of a whole series of agitations, particularly in the south. You had the Vaikom Satyagraha, you had the opening up of temples in Travancore by the Travancore king for the Dalits of that area. You had also opening of temples in various parts of the then Madras presidency. But then she pointed out that while temples may have been opened, there are still patashalas and educational institutions which have not been opened, and drew attention to the fact that in future secular India, this should also be an area that should be of concern, that educational institutions should be open to all. Then you had Santanam, who later on became a finance minister, who talked about the fact that after all, propagation is merely freedom of expression. And the word convert is not there in Article 25. It's very interesting to see that he formulates the right to propagate as a facet of the freedom of expression and says that merely having the right to religion is not sufficient unless you are also able to express it in public. What you do in your house is one thing, what you do outside is a second part, and both of them are coterminous with the right to religion. So he talked about saying the article is not so much about ensuring freedom, but toleration. Toleration for all irrespective of religious practices or professions. Friends, this is the type of debate that went on in the Constituent Assembly, which we need to keep in mind when we now start looking at Article 25, 26, 27, and although the rest of the articles up to 30, because even in the recent Sabarimala case, these articles were interpreted. So it is not as though this debate is fossilized in the late 1940s and has no relevance today. It still has relevance and it still continues to agitate people and groups. It still is an issue that we need to grapple with, and therefore the importance of these various articles. Can we have the slide on Article 25, please? Take you quickly through the slide. We hope you've already been able to see the slides. It says, subject to public order. Now, it's very fascinating. Mr. Vishwanathan, one of our regular listeners, had sent in a comment saying, why is it that Article 25 starts with the restriction, whereas in all other articles, particularly Article 19, 17, 14, the restrictions come at a later point in time. Now, we have been trying to look into the entire debate to find out why the restriction came in the beginning, but this has been the drafting that has been there right from the beginning. Perhaps because of the sensitivity of the whole issue of religion and the fact that it's an emotive issue, they brought in the restrictions right at the beginning. So it says, subject to public order, morality and health. So these are the restrictions. So the restrictions for the freedom of conscience would be public order, morality and health. We have discussed this at length in Article 19, 2 to 6. So please keep those things in mind. All persons. Now, please take note of the fact that it's all persons and not citizens. So anybody who's living in India are equally entitled to freedom of conscience and the right freely to profess, practice and propagate religion. Now, note again, freedom of conscience comes first. And as a facet of that, you come to the next part, which is the right to freely, which means you can't put any cap on it, profess, which is something that you believe in, practice, that is what you show on the outside world as in your relationships, and propagate that which you announce or you share with the wider world in terms of your belief systems. We shall, in a later slide, look at what exactly is religion. Is religion just a theocracy? Is religion just a book? Or is religion a set of beliefs, values, doctrines, etc.? Because these are issues that have come up for interpretation in the courts. Clause 2 says, nothing in this article will affect the operation of any existing law. What in simple words it says that, nothing in the article shall prevent the state, the government, from bringing about any law to regulate or restrict any economic, financial, political, or other secular activity associated with religious practice. I urge you to look at the fact, the word other secular activity. Because one of the things that has been put forth even in the CAA debate is that secularism was brought in by Indira Gandhi during the emergency period with the 42nd Amendment. Secular was never part of the Indian Constitution. This proves a lie that it's not just a preamble. Forget the preamble. You look at Article 25 and several other parts, the word secular continuously keeps appearing. The debate on Article 25 and various other articles are full of secularism. Many Constituent Assembly members cutting across party lines, cutting across religious lines, talk of the acceptance of secularism. So the word secularism was not something that is thought of by Indira Gandhi. It is something which has been there right from the beginning. We need to keep this and take this message to the people of the country, because very soon, once the CAA thing comes up again, we're going to have the same debate all over, starting from scratch. The second part saying, it shall provide for social welfare and reform, or the throwing open of Hindu religious institutions of a public character to all classes and sections of Hindus. The second one particularly applies to Hindus and the Hindu religion. And it talks about three things, social welfare, reform, and throwing open religious institutions. Again, we shall come to this at a later point in time. So what exactly would therefore be religious and what would be secular? Where religion was then defined as something that is related to the religion in terms of the faith, belief, doctrine, practice. Whereas secular would be in terms of the administration of institutions run by religious groups. Where the secular part of the administration would be something which will not come within Article 25, whereas the religious component would come under Article 25. But we shall come to this. Exceptions were given and explanations were given with regard to carrying of kirpans by the Sikhs. You may remember what happens in the whole issue of kirpans in Canada. It's an issue which is still festering there. I think only recently they have permitted, some years back they permitted the Sikhs can carry kirpans, which are part of the religious practice. Then the second thing they said is also talking about Hindus, that Hindus will include Sikhs, Jains and Buddhist religions, which again is something that runs through many other parts of the constitution. Now, if we break up in the next slide, Article 25.1. So in the next slide, you will find that the freedom of conscience is subject. So the conditions are public order, morality, health. And please take note of the other part. And to other provisions of this part, this part is part 3, which means all the other restrictions from 19.2 to 19.6. If you remember, Article 19.2 is the reasonable restriction with regard to freedom of speech and expression, 19.3 for freedom of assembly, then freedom to gather peaceably without arms, and various other things. And Article 14, the right to equality. So all the other restrictions which are there in other parts of Part 3 equally apply when it comes down to Article 25, and not just public order, morality and health. Secondly, as I already said, all persons, and the last part is freedom of conscience, and the right freely to profess, practice and propagate religion. Now we shall look at each of these parts in a little more detail. The basic question that will strike anybody in the next slide is, what is freedom of conscience, and why did they call it a freedom of conscience? Again, when you get through the discussions at various parts, you'll have to cull it out from different parts of the debates. There is a very great sensitivity to the fact of the background of the partition and the bloodbath that followed. Many of the constitution makers are very sensitive to this part, that ultimately what led was a religious divide. And what lay behind it was the fact that it was faith. And that when the issue of faith, that you have to recognize and respect faith. The problem comes when faith is then becomes an adamant issue of saying mine and nothing else, which leads to the type of divisions that we saw at that time. So when they formulated Article 19, which is the original article for 25, the constitution makers were very clear that what comes first is conscience. Now they use a very common sense, it's come through in some later Supreme Court judgments, where the common sense understanding of conscience is a set of parameters in terms of what is good and what is bad, what would contribute towards good behavior and bad behavior, and something that will become a basic rule in terms of guiding a person's actions. Now this set of good conduct rules has nothing to do with religion. It's something to do with us as human beings. If you might now remember all our discussions, the constitution was written in the backdrop of the UDHR. We've been repeatedly talking about it, the whole notion of dignity. All of this is a melting pot out of which freedom of conscience as a term gets connected. They also discuss the fact that freedom of conscience has no connection to religion or to faith in God. You can have faith or you don't need to have faith. Now, the faith can be in a theistic way or an atheistic way. You also had groups like the Urjivikas in India, which there are small pockets of Urjivikas who do not believe in religion or in a Godhead, and believe in basic practice as human beings. Then you have the right of... So it is in this context when they said that freedom of conscience is basically a behavioral tool for each person guiding. Then you go to the next part, that you will now link it up with faith. And after faith comes the whole issue of religion. So it's a step-by-step discussion that takes place. The right, they say, then, of conscience is the right of a person to believe or profess of or have faith in one particular type of a theistic body of knowledge, which looks at life in terms of God or Godhead and various other notions which goes along with that. And they said, we have a right, the Indians in future India should have a right to accept or to take on any religion that they may want to. But the right of the person to be in one religion cannot be the right of somebody else to force you to convert into another religion. We shall come into that. This again is a sore point. It's a point that still is a very difficult issue even as of today. They also, like I said earlier, talk not just about Buddhists and Jains as contra to Hindus. And they talk about 33 crore gods in the Hindu pantheon and so many types of groups and subgroups in that. And then comes the word denomination. What would therefore a denomination be? In Christian and Islamic faith, it's a different meaning. In Hindu, it's a different meaning. And the notion of denomination comes back, and recently in the whole Sabarimala issue, as to whether the Ayyappa bucks would form a denomination or they would not form a denomination. Finally, Article 25, in this larger understanding, that it is freedom of conscience, therefore includes within its ambit the rights of atheists. So just as much as theists have a right to follow their religion, to practice and profess and propagate it, atheists also have the right. And as has been explained earlier, the right of one can only go up to the point that you do not violate the rights of somebody else. Now, these things are very, very real. For example, when you talk about loudspeakers, you have religious functions of all, or religious festivals of various religions, at which point in time throughout the country in different forms, you have loudspeakers blaring. So one thing is ordinary citizens who say, my right to live with a noise-free area or noise without noise pollution is affected, saying that we believe in a different religion. Similarly, atheists can also come forth and say, look, our rights are also being affected. So atheists don't need to be very self-conscious about the fact that freedom of conscience is there, which recognizes their position as atheists. What are the key elements? As we shall see in the next slide, it's available to all persons, not citizens. We've already talked about the balance of freedoms. One person's freedom cannot encroach on somebody else's freedom. And the right to follow a religion or a practice is also a right to overtly express it and to propagate it. And the restrictions are already talked about. In the next slide, we'll see there have been a debate, and later on in the Supreme Court, they have talked about what exactly would right to profess, practice and propagate be. And why did the constitution makers have to talk about the right to profess, practice and propagate? As I said a little earlier, in the Constituent Assembly, there were some people who said this should not be there at all. Religion itself should not be put into the constitution, much less to be given the pride of place as a fundamental right. So there's a whole lot of discussions and debate. And like I pointed out earlier, right to religion as part of a right to expression was also the other type of view that was put forth in the Constituent Assembly. In a set of cases that came up recently, particularly in the case of Reverend Stanislaus versus state of Madhya Pradesh, which came on the whole issue of conversion, the Supreme Court had occasion to look into what exactly is the importance of these three terms, profess, practice, and propagate. And they said, the right to have a religion where you practice it in the privacy of your heart and in the room is not enough, because it becomes meaningless if it does not include two other consequential rights, which is the right to profess. Now, what you profess is what you do in the public. You go to the church, you go to the temple. All these things are public places. And then you practice, which is again both in the private and in the public worship. For example, when you go to a temple and you pray, there's a certain privacy part of it. At the same time, it's also a public part of it. So both of these things are concerned. And then they said, right to propagate then becomes as a sequence, as when you look at it as a progression, the final part, that I have something which I believe in, I practice it, I profess it, which means I declare it to the world, I practice it, it's seen by outside. Finally, I have a right to share the fact that the religion and the practice I am following gives me certain sense of well-being, certain sense of peace, and you share it with others as a way of propagating. So the difficulty comes in when you read into propagating conversion. Does the right to propagate involve the right to convert? And therefore, is it automatic that when you talk about propagation, that it involves the right to convert? This is an issue which has been bedeviling India for the last 70 years. Even now, they're talking about the national law on conversion. But as it stands now, there are 5 states who have brought in anti-conversion laws. Madhya Pradesh, Gujarat, Odisha, Chhattisgarh and Himachal Pradesh. Now, we need to keep in mind that all along, right from the Constituent Assembly times, the fact that I may propagate my religion and share with others the beauty and the joy I feel and the wonder and the well-being that I have experienced with somebody else may lead to that person saying, look, I would also like to follow you. This is a very basic elemental part of Hindu religion, that there are so many different groups and so many different sadhus and so many different sects that people keep on changing also various parts. Let's not forget Kabir. Let's not forget Sai Baba, the world of Cyberman. Let's not figure Tukaram. So many saint gods have been there, and people have been following them. Following them, they have also become separate sects and separate denomination. Now, obviously, when they do it, they may do it or they may not do it with the idea that they will convert you. Some people may be converted. So the issue of conversion becomes an issue only when there is an element of force. So long as force is not involved, the issue of conversion, therefore, does not become violative of Article 25, which allows us the right to freedom of conscience, which then expresses us right to freedom of religion, of which one segment is propagated. So the issue is, if there is an inducement given, if there is something that is done with a conscious motive to brainwash somebody to change, that would be prohibited and not anything else. And those were the issues that were taken up by various laws. The problem comes in, how do you define when somebody has been brainwashed or somebody has been coerced or somebody has been forced to convert? For example, in schools, one of the issues that is always talked about is that many Christian missionary schools are there, and they teach catechism or they teach Sunday classes to students who not necessarily Christian only, but also non-Christians. And that this is an attempt to convert people. Even till recently, there have been many villages across central India which were attacked. For example, during the earlier Raman Singh BJP period in Chhattisgarh, across Chhattisgarh, many tribal areas and tribal villages which were Christian were attacked by the Hindutva groups. And people were not even allowed to access shops, including medical shops, for long periods of time. This has been documented and talked about for 3 to 4 years during the Raman Singh period. Again, I'm pointing out to you that this entire issue is so emotive that it often becomes the place or a site of violence. So when you're talking about propagation and linking it up to violence, we have to keep the distinction between the person's right to talk about and people who may convert, as contrasted to very overt and conscious forms of force or any other form of unnatural conversion that may take place. So they said, what shall be the test? What will be the test to look at the practice of religion? There are two parts to it. One is in terms of practice of religion, in terms of the fundamental right, as also the later rights which come in Article 25, 26, and subsequently. So the Supreme Court identified three sets, and they are linked with each other. It is based on a doctrine and a belief. There is a faith, and there's a practice and a tenet. On the outside part of it, the doctrine and the belief is related to the nature of worship. The element of faith can be correlated with the rituals, and the practices and tenets of a particular religion is also then linked to the type of customs that particular religious group, religion or a subgroup of that religion may be following. Now, the right to follow the rituals and observances should be regarded as an integral part of the religion by followers of a doctrine. Now, I'll give you very shortly some examples of how this became an issue. For example, there was a group called the Anand Margis, which became an issue in terms of their practice of the Shiva Tandava dance in public, where they would carry a skull, they would carry a live snake, they would carry a Trishul and various other paraphernalia of Shiva performing the Tandava dance, which was done in a cemetery, which they then transformed it as saying, this is an integral part of our faith. They asked for permission to go on a procession in Calcutta, which was refused in 1983, saying this will, contrary to giving people an idea of the religious practice, is not part of the practice of the Anand Margis, which is a very new sect. They are a new denomination. And therefore, not having or following that practice does not mean that their religion will be curtailed. And therefore, the Commissioner of Police refused to give him permission. This went up to the Supreme Court. Supreme Court looked at the thing and said, how do you judge as to whether a practice is an integral part of the religion? And then they said, an integral part of a religion is something where a large number of people identify that as part of their religion. And if you remove that part of that particular practice which is sought to be prohibited, then the core of that religion or the belief in that religion will be changed. So Supreme Court said, we cannot give you that permission. And for the specific thing of how to do that, they sent it back to the Calcutta High Court. Then it came back to the state. There, a single judge looked into the whole matter. Several years went by. And then they gave permission. A division bench looked into that. And this matter once again went back to the Supreme Court in 2004. In the Supreme Court, there was a divided opinion. There was a three-judge bench, two judges as to one judge. And the two judges said, giving this particular ratio, they said, of course, now, by that time, already 20 years had passed when the Anand Marg had been started. Anand Marg was supposed to have been started around 1955, 56. Several decades have passed, and many of those things have become regular practices, though they were not allowed to do this in public. And therefore, they said, if it is an integral part, it has to be something which a bulk of the believers believe and follow it. And if they don't believe it, they feel that they have not been allowed, that their rights are being violated. Only in that instance will it then be seen to be a violation of the fundamental right under Article 25. And therefore, the Supreme Court, it was a divided opinion where one judge said, no, it need not be long in practice. It could be even recent. It could be a new, Justice A.R. Lakshman was a dissenting judge in that particular ruling, in which he said, if the religious teacher tells the people that you have to follow a particular thing, and you don't follow that particular practice, then you are not a true believer. And therefore, this long practice and long custom need not be the test to look at whether it's a religious practice sufficiently warranting protection under Article 25. That is there. But this again is a problematic issue. For example, there was a group called the Meivai Salai people in Tamil Nadu, and there was this sadhu whose followers came from very highly respected, very wealthy backgrounds. He would spit, and people would fight over each other to take a part of the spittle. You know, so there are all types of vague and very crazy type of things that you find all around. And therefore, if the state is to come in to regulate that, do they have a right or not, is always a contentious issue. Another part linked to that is the whole issue of processions. Particularly, for example, Ram Navami processions going around masjids, or Muslim processions going around temple areas. Which processions can be allowed? When can it not be allowed? These are always issues that have agitated courts and people. Now, processions again comes to an issue. Can you have a bar on a procession passing a religious house of practice for all time, meaning 24 hours a day? Or do you say that you can regulate it so that if they're going to pass a particular house of worship, the hours in which that worship is going to be held, or pujas or namaz is going to be held, or services are going to be held, only for that limited period you can have a prohibition, but you cannot have an all-time prohibition. This is the larger ratio that's been held by the Supreme Court, which is the law as it stands now, that you cannot have a blanket prohibition, and you have to look into the account of the practices in that area in terms of how exactly you will regulate the proceedings rather than completely suppress it or gag that expression. Now, an issue of Article 25, again, goes back to the whole issue of secularism. Can a secular state be also take into account the whole issue of religion? And the other part of it is secularism at all part of the Constitution? This again is an issue which went up to the Supreme Court in a case which looked at, it's called the S.R. Bommai case, a very famous case where there were 9 judges. There were divided opinions on a whole lot of issues. But the majority ruling talked about 7 seminal elements of secularism, very much linked to Article 25, 26, 28, 29, and 30. One that they said, and this is again very important in the light of contemporary issues. In that particular case, it was a series of states where the state governments had been dissolved using Article 356 emergency powers. S.R. Bommai was the Chief Minister of Karnataka. Likewise, in Nagaland, in some of the northeastern states, about 8 to 10 states assemblies had been dissolved in 1992-93 when Narasimha Rao of the Congress government was there and Manmohan Singh was the Finance Minister. All these issues went up to the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court had occasion to look at the power of Article 356. One of the issues which came up in that was the fact that the issue of religious divide between the central government and the state governments was an issue which became primary in terms of dismissing various governments. And that is how the issue of secularism came to be discussed in that case. Now, it's a very lengthy 250 plus page judgment. The core elements, they said, is that the constitution prohibits the establishment of a theocratic state. This is the sum and substance of the entire constitutional assembly debate, is what they said. Two, is that not only is a state prohibited from establishing a religion of its own, it's prohibited from identifying itself or favoring any particular religion. The third, he said, secularism does not mean that it is anti-God or it is an atheist society. Secularism means that the state shall remain equidistant between all religions. Now, I'm pointing this out because one of the issues secularism was attacked, even during the parliamentary debate recently on the CAA and related issues, was the fact that the idea of secularism means that you are being atheistic or that it means it's an anti-God and therefore it is anti-faith. All along, the whole notion has been secularism does not talk about faith, does not talk about X or Y religion. It is also attacked. I mean, the current debate also attacks secularism, saying it's a Western value. It's not. From 1940s and during the Constituent Assembly, the whole notion of secularism was debated threadbare. And they said the understanding of secularism in India in the 40s, given the backdrop of partition, is not on the Western notion of a distinction between the state and the church, where both of them were coterminous. To the contrary, in a multi-varied society with such religious, communal, caste diversity, you needed the state to keep itself away from either both caste as also community and religion and be equidistant from all of them, which has nothing to do with being atheistic or anti-God or anti-faith or anything else. It all that it means is that it does not favor one group over the other. And secondly, if you may remember the whole notion of right to equality, it also means at the same time that the constitutional ethos looks at the marginalized societies, looks at social justice. That is also one of the aims of the constitution. So secularism, while on one hand means you remain equidistant, it also is committed to the larger constitutional ethos as in the preamble and in Part 3. Secularism, they talked about as being a basic feature of the constitution. If it's a basic feature of the constitution, then there's a bar on changing the notion of secularism. Again, an issue that is very germane today and important for all of us to understand so that in our discussions, in our talk, in our writings, we express these ideas. All political parties participating in elections should abide by this principle of secularism and the Representation of People's Act to talk about secular democracy. And finally, communalization of politics is anti-secular. The majority ruling of a 9-judge bench which talked about this. Now, if you see the last 4.4 to 0.7, we see it in its breach in India rather than in its observance. In the next slide, just a few interesting cases where some of these things had been taken up. For example, bursting firecrackers. Now, this issue of firecrackers and noise in churches, in masjids, in temples have been repeatedly going up. Okay, many of these things have for many years been there but not really being implemented until recently. For example, when they talk about challenge, when the state comes up with laws regulating the practice of various religions, and these things are taken to court and the tests are applied there. And like this is where we now go back to the earlier slide we talked about. Is it an elementary part of a religion that if you stop it or you prevent it from happening, that religion itself changes its character? If it is not, then that the protection under Article 25 will not be there. So based on this, for example, in the case called In Re Noise Pollution, the series of rulings on that, they talked about the fact that for bursting firecrackers for Diwali is not part of a religion. Apart from Diwali, there's a Tiruvuram festival in Kerala. There are many other festivals across India. For example, in the Northeast, they burst firecrackers in some of the states, Northeastern states. They said, if you bar them from firecrackers, because it affects ordinary people, as also the elders and others, that does not by itself mean that the religion is devalued. And therefore, any rule which comes out to regulate these things are valid. Similarly, they talked about, for example, the Church of God versus a KKR Majestic Resident Welfare Association, which went up in Karnataka. Again, a similar rule came there. Now, whether to use a cone mic or a box mic are again issues. Rules are very clear. The Supreme Court rulings are there. Unfortunately, it's not being implemented. It is up to us as citizens to make sure that these things are implemented. Now, same thing. For example, human sacrifices in the name of religion. This is an old practice that we have. Can you therefore say that any law which bars it is wrong? No, you cannot, because one of the restrictions is morality. And you're talking about civilizational values and civilizational morality. Therefore, human sacrifice cannot be. Similarly, they talk about deliberate acts which will wound the feelings of other people. Again, these would be situational, and these will be from circumstance to circumstance. Again, the test would be, are they done deliberately and consciously? Would they affect or create ill feelings amongst other sects? If it does, then preventing that is a part of the regulation that the state will have to do. The issue of cow sacrifice during Muslim festival. Again, in a case which went up from Gujarat, they said the sacrifice of cow is not obligatory part as enjoined by the Muslim religion. And therefore, insisting that you will sacrifice, like for example, during Bakrid, that you should sacrifice a cow, does wound the sensibilities of other sections of the people. And Supreme Court said it's not an obligatory part, and therefore a rule which came preventing or stopping that would not be illegal or unconstitutional. The very interesting case about came in the context of election laws, saying that you have the election voter card. So do you can the people belonging to the Islamic community say we will not allow photographs of our women? The courts have said no, you cannot do that. Because there's a difference between a religious practice and something like this, which is part of the secular realm, and we need to keep this distinction alive. This again pointing out to the fact that these are the varied type of issues that we can see all around. Then we have now looked at 25, quickly go through some of the other ones. For example, Article 25.2b, which talks about providing for social welfare and reform and throwing open Hindu religious institutions. Several of you had sent in comments saying, why is there a separate provision only for Hindu religious institutions and why not for others? Again, this has much to do with the period in which the constitution was made. Many people came and said, Hinduism and Hindus are the majority religion. We should be the example for the secular state that we have there. That's one. Two is that behind the independence movement was also the largest social movement against caste discrimination, against untouchability, against gender-based issues. So the gender-based issues was not much to the fore. So it is in this context that when the constitution makers wrote and the committee which was drafting this part of the constitution, they said, no, we have to have a separate provision within the Hindu thing because of its varied nature and also for the wide variety of discriminatory practices all across India. And no two practices and no two regions had the same type of a practice. And it would be very, very varied. So it is in this context, as I said, you need to embed a protection in the law. Now, a very interesting part of the debate is there in the Constituent Assembly debate, where one of the persons asked, why did you have to put Hinduism and Hindu religion into the fundamental right chapter? Why couldn't you have put it in some other part? There it was very clearly said, we are paying the price for religious divide. We also, in a way, paying the price for caste division at that period. We don't want a future India, a future legislative authority to come and say, we are not going to allow you any religious freedom at all. And therefore, it is in a way to protect the rights of people who have faith that we are bringing in the provision of 25 to 28 and putting it into the constitution. And it proceeds with the whole freedom of conscience. So that is how it was worded. And they said we needed to put it. So Article 25.2b was taking into account the fact that amongst and within the Hindu community itself, there was a very major movement for social justice, particularly in the southern provinces of what is now Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, Kerala, Andhra, Maharashtra, where there was a long 100-year campaign against untouchability, for caste equality, and against Brahminical values. Now, it is in this context that 25.2b was brought about and basically meant to bring about social reform and eradication of practices and dogma. So for example, there are several cases on the whole Hindu law codification, the law banning marrying of two wives amongst Hindus. Again, this came about because of Article 25.2b, prohibition of sati and devadasis and laws which came regarding devadasis again were confirmed, taking recourse to Article 25(2)(b). Right to hereditary succession of archakas. Now this is where, as I pointed out to you earlier, there's a difference between religious practice and practices of administration of religious institutions which are secular in nature and not religious. So they talked about a temple and a temple administration. Temple practice would be religion coming under Article 25. But the administration of the temples would form secular activities, and therefore they would be they cannot take recourse to Article 25. So the appointment of archakas or the chief priests, they said, is not part of religious usage. Here they again take recourse to the whole issue of social reform, saying that only one particular set of caste people can be allowed to become archakas, which is bad, and you should now open it up to other people. For example, in Tamil Nadu, for example, it used to be only Brahmins largely, though not completely, who could become archakas. So there was a caste social justice movement said, this is discriminatory and this should be changed. Laws were brought about to change that. And they were upheld, or they can be argued to be upheld based on Article 25B. So that is again with regard to as to why there was a special provision with regard to Article 25(2)(b). We'll now quickly go through Article 26, freedom to manage religious affairs. This is a consequence of Article 25. So you have been given personal rights in Article 25 to freedom of profess, propagate, etc. Article 25(2) gives you various other rights in terms of the practice of the religion. Article 26 is the next part. What is, you move away from the personal realm into the public realm. And when in the public realm, what are the rights that a group, a collective with a religious identity have in terms of managing their religious affairs? Again, they said subject to public order, morality and health. It doesn't say and other parts of the part three. So as far as managing religious affairs are concerned, only these three parts are there. Every religious denomination shall have the right to establish and maintain institutions for religious and charitable purposes and to manage its own affairs in matters of religion. The other two are for acquisition of movable and immovable properties and to administer such property in accordance with law. The more important ones in public domain are A and B in terms of religious and charitable institution and purposes. In the next slide, we will see that education, we look at the religious denomination. So, for example, the most important aspect is how do you therefore define religious denomination? So it says, one, it must be a collection of individuals who have a system of beliefs or doctrines which they regard as conducive to their spiritual well-being, that is a common faith. There should be a common organization around it. And three is that there should be a designation by a distinctive name. So these would go into what becomes a religious denomination. If any one of these three are not there, then it will not be a religious denomination. It will just be a religious group. So to get protection of Article 26, you need to be identifiable as a religious denomination, which is very, very important. For example, mutt. There are religious mutts within the Hindu religion. For example, the Ramakrishna mutt, the Vivekananda mission. These are all various religious denominations. Then the Gauda Saraswat Brahmin community is again recognized as a separate group within the Raja Brahmin community. Parsi communities are seen as subsects or separate religious denominations. Ananda Margis, first 20 years they were not, now because they're about 50 years old, they are now looked at as a separate denomination and therefore entitled to protection. Then you have the Chishtiya sect of the Muslims. Okay, Article 26(1) only safeguards of rights of denominations which they originally had, not in terms of creating new rights. Right to establish educational institutions. Education has been recognized as a charitable activity, which is why the fundamental rights of many Christian and Muslim institutions to have their own colleges. I will now run through because we are running out of time and Saila has to take the last two parts. Denominations not falling under Article 29 and 30 will also, but however, will have rights to establish and maintain under Article 26. Okay. For example, the TMA Pi Foundation, the DAV schools, the Brahmo Samaj Educational Society, the many, many other schools and colleges and educational institutions which have been recognized as charitable institutions to run their institutions. What is important to note, for example, TMAPI Foundation, then there's this other Islamic foundation where the fees and the cap, whether capitation fees, they can they have to follow the government norms or not, have all been adjudicated in the Supreme Court. Supreme Court has very clearly held that while in the matter of religion, the religious practice would be protected, as far as management and administration and fees are concerned, they are secular and they will have to conform to other laws. Article 27, freedom as to payment of taxes, in very simple terms at the bottom part, it says that in a secular state, the money that is being collected as tax cannot be used to help maintain or promote any particular religion or denomination. It's again a consequence of or a continuation, Article 25 and 26. And the last article is about attendance at religious instructions or religious worship of certain educational institutions. That no religious instruction should be provided in any educational institution wholly maintained out of state funds. Because they made an exception to it, saying that if a particular educational institution was started by a trust, which required as part of the trust deed that religious instruction should be provided, then that particular institution would not be barred from having religious instruction, although it may be a state-aided institution. Okay. These are again issues of greater detail, which we do not look at in greater detail just now, but it's something that we need to know so we can look at it if a particular issue comes about. With that, we cover the first part, Article 25 to 28, and we look at the second part of it, which is Article 29 and 30, which Saila will now take.
So far we have, Suresh has dealt with religion and religious minorities. So now we are moving to Article 29, which is the next slide. Protection of interests of minorities. Any section of the citizens residing in the territory of India or any part thereof, having a distinct language, script or culture of its own. So please see here, the word religion is absent. Here we are moving on to a next category where we are looking at linguistic minorities or people with distinct script or culture of their own. They shall have the right to conserve the same. And no citizen shall be denied admission into any educational institution maintained by the state or receiving aid out of state funds on grounds only of religion, race, caste, language, or any of them. Now, interestingly, Article 29 starts with the language of minorities, protection of interests of minorities. We must also recollect, as we have been saying from the very beginning, that our constitution was framed not only in the context of our independence movement, but also in the larger context of events globally. So we had the First World War, the Second World War, and the various scenarios which the world had witnessed in terms of violence, in terms of the League, formation of the League of Nations, the UN, all these things were also in the backdrop, and the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. So we must understand that the whole issue of protecting the rights of minorities was in the context of the history of the 18th and 19th centuries, where with the formation of nation states, see earlier when we were all living as small tribes or as small groups of communities with no connection with the rest of the world, and each community was able to preserve and conserve their own distinct language, script or culture. But the moment nation states were formed and there were these huge geographical areas which were all consolidated as one state over a larger umbrella of a common administration, then you had the dominant communities who were then oppressing the less dominant communities who were minority in terms of numbers. And these communities were constantly coming together to protect their language, their specific culture, and this was an ongoing phenomenon globally. And it was in this context that after the First World War, when the League of Nations was formed, there was something called the Minority Treaties, where every nation who wanted to become a part of the League of Nations was asked to sign that they would respect minority rights in their respective nations. So while it was not, of course, followed, it was followed more in breach, but as a notion of recognizing minority rights, it started with the League of Nations. It continued to be adopted in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights and in the formation of the United Nations. So we must also understand that we were also influenced by what was happening globally, apart from what we were also experiencing in our own nation in terms of the various religious minorities. So it was in this context that the word minority is also used, because one of the main issues in terms of minorities globally, when the Universal Declaration of Human Rights was passed, is to also firstly to recognize the existence of minorities, to recognize the fact that they have a distinct language, scripture, or culture or religion, even religious minorities, and the commitment of nation states to protect these minorities so that they are not overridden by the dominant culture. So this was the reason why the title says that protection of interests of minorities. But the protection, as we have seen earlier, the religion, right to religion is not just to minorities. It is of course extended to majorities, and whatever rights the minorities enjoy, the majority does enjoy. So it is not as if the minorities alone are given certain rights. It is easier for majorities to take these rights for granted, because being the dominant group, they anyway enjoy these rights. It is only for the minorities that you need special protection to recognize that they have a distinct language, script, and culture which needs protection. So it is in this context that Article 29.1 was enacted, and 29.2 provides that nobody will be denied admission in any educational institution maintained by state or any institution receiving aid out of state funds. Now you may wonder, on grounds only of religion, race, caste, language, or any of them, you may wonder why this clause is being repeated, because Articles 14, 15, which we have seen earlier, 15.2, already provides for this kind of non-discrimination. But one addition to 15 that we find in Article 29 is that it is not just applicable to state institutions, but it is also extended to private institutions which are receiving state funds. So there is an additional protection given as far as education is concerned, because there were a number of private institutions aided, which we refer to as aided institutions. And the constitution makers felt that access to education should also be available to everybody, and there should be no discrimination on for reasons of religion, race, caste, language, or any of them. Now moving to the next slide, where we have just discussed some instances of Article 29. So interestingly, the Representation of People's Act, which guides our entire election process, made it an offense for any person to canvass votes on the basis of religion or even language. So one such case came up to the Supreme Court, where a candidate was accused of corrupt practices for garnering votes by ensuring the voters that they will protect their language. The Supreme Court has said that we must read the provisions of the Representation of People's Act in the context of the guarantees under Article 29.1, and says that there is nothing wrong if a person says that he or she will protect the language of a particular minority community, and that will not be a election malpractice. So it was in that context that Article 29 was also referred to. Then another interesting case was in the case of Usha Mehta versus Maharashtra, where the Maharashtra state government insisted that all schools should teach Marathi. They brought in what we today understand as the three language formula, where we have the medium of communication, which is generally either English medium or any other medium. Then you have the second language and the third language. So at that point in time, the Supreme Court said that, and this was challenged, saying that you are now asking the linguistic minorities to learn a different language. So the Supreme Court said, well, it is true that you have a right to protect your language, but there is no negative right that you will not learn any other language. So in that context, they said that, so compelling that people belonging to a particular state should also learn the regional language will not be a violation of Article 29, because there is no negative right not to learn a language. This is only a positive right to protect a existing language. And one more context was in terms of changing the medium of communication in schools. So that they said it is a violation, because if you insist that all minority institutions should teach only in a particular language, then that would amount to the detriment of their language, then that would amount to a violation of their right under Article 29. So we see the difference between the two bullet points, where one is they say they deny a negative right, but on the other hand, they say that the positive right is available. Now going to the next slide, Article 30. Article 30 is in the context of giving rights of minorities to establish and administer educational institutions. Now the reason why the religious minorities were given this, because part of the process of conserving their own religion, their language and their culture was also to establish schools for their own communities to propagate and to spread and to preserve and conserve these culture and their other distinct identities. So that is the reason why Article 30 was enacted, and they said that all minorities, whether based on religion or language, so you have both religious minorities and linguistic minorities, they have a right to establish and administer educational institutions of their choice. And in making any law for compulsory education, of course this was a later amendment where they said that whenever any of the properties of the educational institutions were bought, they would be paid adequate compensation, because if the properties are taken away and then adequate compensation is not paid, then it would result in them not being able to actually propagate their religion or to administer their various institutions. And hence, any such acquisition of property should not result in the abrogation of the rights, and hence they brought in this amendment. And then they have said that the state shall not, in granting aid or educational institutions, discriminate against any educational institution on the ground that it is under the management of a minority, whether based on religion or language. So in the granting of state aid, the state cannot discriminate on grounds of either religion or language. So this is another protection given under Article 30. Now moving to the next slide. One of the main questions which came up again and again was, who is a minority or what constitutes a minority? Now, internationally also, there is no set defined definition as to what constitutes a minority, except what is broadly accepted is that they are numerically smaller in number and that they are not a dominant group. And they should also have a desire to protect their common identity, language, religion, practice, culture, etc. Now, again, this is again going back to the international context. While this is a broadly accepted category, the numerical aspect of the criteria is not universal, because again, they said most of it is fact specific. For instance, we all know the apartheid regime in South Africa. It was the minority whites who actually oppressed the majority blacks. So oppression need not always be in terms of numerical strength. You could have a smaller minority oppressing the larger majority, and hence the numbers may not always define minorities. But what would be more relevant is that it is not dominant. They are not dominant in terms of being able to have the space and the freedom to conserve their own culture and religion or language. So that was in terms of the global context. But as far as India is concerned, Supreme Court has gone by numbers. They said if there is less than 50% in terms of the numbers, then it would be a constituted minority. Now, when you say, and they have actually, we have now an act in place, but before the act came into place, by series of judicial judgments, judicial pronouncements and interpretation, courts have held that minority is something which can be defined in terms of numbers. And then when you say number Now, what is the unit? Should you take the state as a unit or the center as a unit, that is all of India as a unit? They said it depends upon the legislation, where if it is a state legislation, you take the state as a unit and look at whether a particular religion or a language is a minority within a state. If it is a central legislation, then you look at the center as a category. But that has now been now reversed by the Supreme Court in the TMM Kappai case, where they said you take the state as a unit to decide whether a particular religion or a linguistic minority is a minority body or not. And as far as religion is concerned, today we have an enactment which provides for the central government to notify which are the communities which are minorities, and the central government has notified Muslims, Christians, Sikhs, Buddhists, Parsis and Jains as religious minorities in India. Jains were notified only as late as 2014, but though this enactment has come into place only now, from the time of the constitution, these communities and these religions have been recognized and their rights have been safeguarded by courts interpreting it, by giving it in terms of the numerical strength. And now, as I said, that the state is a unit and therefore deciding the minority states. Of course, in the TMAPI judgment, it was not a unanimous judgment. Two judges felt that the earlier criteria which the courts have adopted, where depending upon the application of the act, whether it was a state act or a central act, we should take the state as a unit or a central as a unit, because there may be situations where the government of India, for instance, the imposition of Hindi, if there was a legislation brought in today to say that we will impose Hindi, then if you look at the nation as a unit, then that would be problematic, because each, for instance, in the southern states, if you were to look at as a minority, then if you look at the Hindi speaking as a minority, then it will not happen. So they said that could actually result in problems, but probably we will deal with it later. I mean, maybe court, the law will evolve as we go along. No, but as far as India is concerned, this is the category today. That's where it rests. Then now going back to Article 30, where they have said that minorities have the right to establish their educational institutions. We are just breaking up those provisions. Now, what you require to keep in mind is that the language used is establish and administer. The courts have repeatedly held that both these words have to be read conjunctively, which means that an institution will have to do, in order to get the protection of Article 30, should be both established and administered by the minorities. So if you look at a situation where it was not established by a minority, but subsequently the administration moved to minorities, then it will not enjoy the protection of Article 30, or the vice versa. If it was established by a minority, but today the administration does not lie with the minority, then also it will not apply. So the words established and administered will have to be read together, and only if both are satisfied, then alone it will qualify for a protection as a minority institution. Until recently, how do institutions decide whether they satisfy this establish and administer formula which has been provided for in the constitution? The institutions used to go to the civil court, and you will have to lead evidence, because this is a question of fact, whether it was established by minorities and whether it is administered by minorities. So you will have to lead evidence in court and obtain a decree from a civil court saying that it is, you are a minority institution. So since that proved to be a very cumbersome process, the government of India, we today have a National Commission of Minority Educational Institutions, where a certificate can be issued by this institution to declare a particular institution to be a minority. Now, what is it that the rights of minority can be? For instance, they can decide on admissions, appointments, medium of instruction, composition of the board, and so on. Now, let us move on to the next slide. Now, while minority institutions are guaranteed certain protections that they have the right to administer, courts have held that the right to administer does not mean that you have the right to maladminister. And it does not mean that you have no responsibility to ensure that certain basic standards of education are being maintained. And when certain standards are being imposed, you cannot say that it is a violation of your fundamental rights. And hence they said that it is open to the government to regulate minority institutions by imposing standards. They have divided into two categories of regulation. One is a regulation by way of standards, and the other is a second type of regulation, which is the management of the institutions. The first category, which is the imposing of standards, which is setting out the syllabus, the course content, the minimum qualifications for teachers, then minimum things like your structural stability, maintaining some basic sanitation, health, hygiene. Now, these are all standards which are required for the running of an efficient institution. And these standards cannot be seen as a violation of your minority rights. But however, the court said, when it moves to management of the institution, which is the administration of the institution, then government should be slow to intervene in it. And they have said that whatever regulations that you may impose, it should not result in taking away the right to administer. For instance, as we said, that they can have a right to impose standards in respect of teachers or imposition of fees. Here we have just given the example of fees can be regulated, but admissions is their choice. So today, in terms of fee regulation, you have a committee today which regulates fee to minority institutions, including all professional institutions. But the candidates whom they will appoint, who will admit into the institution, is something which is left to the choice of the educational institution. Now, moving to the next slide. Can we move to the next slide? Okay, there is no next slide. Fine. Let me just expand on these things. As far as the regulation of management and institutions are concerned, for instance, while they may say that a particular set of teachers should be appointed, in terms of qualifications, the choice of the teacher, the choice of the principal, the choice of the correspondent rests with the management. Then when we say that they can decide on the medium have a syllabus, but the minority institution can decide on what would be the nature of language of communication. So this is the kind of fine distinction that the Supreme Court brought about between laying down standards and actually interfering with the minority rights to administer. The application of labor laws, labor welfare legislation, the Industrial Disputes Act, which we have discussed when we were dealing with the right to freedom of association and also the right against exploitation. All the labor welfare legislations would apply equally to minority institutions. There have been instances where many minority institutions have challenged the application of the Industrial Disputes Act, saying that it would be a violation of the minority rights. Courts have held, no, it will not amount to a violation of the minority rights. Then you have the private educational institutions for regulating the service conditions of teachers, for regulating the service conditions of non-teaching staff in educational institutions. Now, such regulations, they have said that they have, in fact, made a fine distinction. While they have the right to take disciplinary action against the minority institutions, they will have to follow some fair procedure. Fair procedure that we have seen, as seen in Article 14, which is they should be put on notice, they should be given an opportunity. Now, all those procedures would apply to minority institutions as well, and that will not be a violation of their right to administer. Now, there have been clauses in educational institutions where they said you need to get prior permission of the department in order to appoint or to terminate teachers. So they said that clause, to the extent they say that minority institutions should get prior permission before you dismiss or terminate the services, would be a violation of the minority rights. But providing a right of appeal to a teacher who has been dismissed is not a minority right. So if you see that great care has been taken at every point in time by the courts in India, that whenever regulations have been formulated to regulate the affairs of the administration of minority rights, they have taken great care to balance that at on the one hand that the employees or the students are protected, but on the other hand the right of the minority institutions to administer their organizations is preserved. So this has been a delicate balance which has been constantly been endeavored. Repeated challenges were there, both from employees, by students, as well as by the administrations. But courts have gone out of their way to ensure that these rights are protected, while also balancing the rights of the parties concerned. So with this, I think we'll conclude our presentation, and then we'll leave it open for questions.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, sir. Should we start with the question?
Yes, yeah. Please.
I've been instance, Aishwarya. I'd like to congratulate all of you. Some very, very nice questions have come in. I wish we could have an interactive way by which we all could share, but unfortunately the medium is not allowing it. But thanks for everybody. Lots of very good questions have come. So shoot, Aishwarya.
Yes. First one is from Suhas Kolhekar. Children of an interreligious couple, so do they get to decide as adults as to which religion they identify with, or is it the religion of their father or mother? In fact, there is another person who asked a similar question, as in religion is in one way imposed on children too. So does the law say anything about the religion of children?
See, as a faith, as a belief, and as a practice, definitely it is left to the individual to choose between the to choose the religion of either of their parents, or to choose a third religion altogether. So that option is always available to the religion, to the individual. But I think where the issues may come is if you are seeking some benefits from the state on account of your religious identity. That's where the whole issue of whether you can be recognized as which religion, because as far as caste is concerned, that has been a very big issue. Now, what is the caste of a child who's born to parents of two different castes? So do they take the caste of the mother, or do they take the caste of the father? So, but as of now, because we are still in a patriarchal society, you take the caste of the father. As far as religion is concerned, I think essentially it is also what is the practice that the person professes at home. So that would determine. So I think, as I said, there is no bar in practicing, but as when you claim, then establishing it may be the issue.
All right. The next question is from Sri Lakshmi Anantanarayana. What was the idea that went behind declaring some religions as minorities and some as majority religions? Is it the view that over the years we will aim to achieve equal numbers and do away with the term minority?
No, not at all. See, the numbers will always be different. There is no attempt at equalizing the numbers, because there are so many religions. So how do you equalize numbers? It is only in respect of protecting their own religious identity, their culture, their practice. So it is essentially protecting the diverse and the pluralistic nature of our society. So plurality is the essence of our society, and it is to conserve that plurality and to ensure that we don't homogenize and make it all, you know, one uniform robotic kind of a society. We would like to be different. I mean, there is a richness. I mean, today we see the cuisine. We are all eating, food of, of a global. We go for, Italian and Chinese and Japanese and continental, apart from our local cuisine. So it is this diversity which is actually making our life interesting. And it is a diversity. I mean, today, I think whether it is music, the influence of the Persian Mughal culture, on art, music, on our even on our, most of our food, I think has been phenomenal. And there's been so much integration, and out of that integration, you know, a fusion is emerging. So I don't think the idea is to make it homogeneous, but it is rather to conserve each of the individual identities so that that richness is not lost.
Take the issue, for example, of Hindi language. North India, many people in North India would like to push Hindi as a main thing. Actually, Hindi is not the majority language in across North India. There's so many other languages which are equally spoken, from Bhojpuri to Maithili to various other languages which exist there, and not just Hindi. But the push has been only towards one single language. We discussed at an earlier occasion on the push to homogenize Ramayana. That about 1100 to 1200 varieties of Ramayana, the ruling dispensation wants one single version, and they are seeking to bring in that single version. So the issue of majority minority is not to homogenize. To say that, you know, you equalize at some point in time. Actually, there's politics in this whole issue of equalizing. In fact, that is one of the things by which rabble rousing is taking place. Cow vigilantism, you have the lynchings, all of that is built on the whole thing that the Muslim communities are breeding like rabbits. In 10 years' time or 20 years' time, they will overtake the number of Hindus in India.
Or Christians are converting.
So this numerical part is not the issue. What is there is in terms of ultimately what has been the historical culture of India, which is recognizing the diversity of people in India, recognizing the fact that we are different, recognizing the fact that we have our distinct identities, and yet that there are some common aspects in which we can relate. In fact, the term kudum that we are using for our lectures is precisely based on managing diversity by not seeking uniformity or homogeneity, but by saying we recognize difference, live with conflict, and create consensus. So the whole issue of majority-minority is a very political issue of handling differences and making sure that groups which are small in number and therefore lack political power are not whitewashed by other groups which are stronger, both numerically as also in terms of wealth and access to power.
In fact, there is an entire, because when I was mentioning to you about the global debate, that minority and majority is not always on numbers. It is on whether you are not in a, or you are being dominated by, or because of your not dominant position, you are unable to actually practice and conserve your own culture. So as we have pointed out in apartheid South Africa, where the black majority was large in numbers, but the white minority was actually oppressing them and denying them their rights, both political, social, everything else. So there is an entire debate whether women should actually be treated as minorities, because while women may actually be equal in number in terms of the men, in a patriarchal society, women actually suffer all the disadvantages of minority communities. So there is an entire feminist debate on women as minority communities, and women actually that they should be given equal kind of protection to preserve their own identity, their own rights, and their own aspirations. So, and today you have sexual minorities. So, I mean, you today the concept of minority itself is ever widening. In terms of sexual orientation, in terms of what about those who are differently able? What about the rights of the differently able? They are also a minority when you say minority, it is that section of society who have certain special needs, certain special requirements, or certain special cultures. Now, do we as a society give room to ensure that their rights, their needs, and their aspirations are taken care of? So that is a simple, you know, larger political and social understanding of minorities. So it is number is one aspect of it, because by and large, a smaller number is more in danger of being oppressed when compared to if you are in larger number. Just the sheer fact that you have a brute majority in terms of numbers, you are able to ensure certain safeguards. So, but as I said, that is not the only rule. We have seen a different example in the world history where in Africa it was different. So can we move on to the next question?
Okay. The next question is from Abha. How do we as a society address religious reform of majority and minority religions? How do we balance social reform with the freedom to believe, profess, and propagate?
Actually, this is something that was also debated in the Constituent Assembly with a very clear warning, saying that let it not be something which is forced, that reform should come willingly, voluntarily, and by an organic process from inside each communities. This can come about only when there is true fraternity amongst the various communities. So we now go back to the word fraternity of the preamble. So I'm saying, say, every time you look at many of these issues, you see the sagacity of our constitution makers in putting it. See, I'm not trying to create one romantic image of the constitution makers or as though this is the final document that there can be. But I'm seeing a lot of the difficulties, the challenges, and the angst of that period is reflected in that. So the ideal way would be where people of both majority and minority communities are educated in a open-ended way, in a critical learning manner, so that the process of reform happens both within the community as also in terms of interrelationship between various communities, rather than being forced by the government. The force, if at all, should come in extreme things like, say, prohibiting sati or similar such practices, which are extremely brutal and extremely against the basic ethos of humanism.
See, just to add to what Suresh was saying, it has not been an easy journey as far as reform is concerned, when it is also closely linked to religion, because you know the sentiments that can whip up. So when the Hindu code was originally introduced in the constitution, in the parliament, there was a lot of, I mean, Hindu code was essentially dealing with marriage, with the rights, with the divorce, with the adoption, guardianship, with property rights. So we know that the earlier are all these, you know, personal laws, which we today call as personal laws, is very closely linked to religion. And so our whole Hindu marriage is a religious ceremony, and the whole concept of divorce, though it was in practice, it was never recognized by religion. Then property rights, women were denied property rights, and women were not allowed to adopt, because the datta homam, which was again a religious practice, was only done by a man. And so these were the kind of where your civic rights, that is your rights as an individual, which is your right to marry, your right to divorce, your right to, you know, adopt, are all, and your right to property, were all closely linked to religion. So when the Hindu code was brought in as a one comprehensive code to deal with all aspects, there was stiff opposition. And in fact, Ambedkar, who drafted the Hindu code, resigned in protest because there was a lot of opposition to introducing these laws. And then Jawaharlal Nehru, in order to, you know, buy peace, he said, okay, let us go step by step. We will first deal with marriage and divorce, and then we will deal with the other aspects later on. So it took almost a period of 10 years to bring in 1956, that is, if you're looking at from the time when the constitution and the Hindu bill was first drafted to its passing, by the Hindu Marriage Act, the Hindu Succession Act, came only in the year 1956 and in, you know, in installments. And finally, the copassionary rights of women, which is the right to women to ancestral property, to inherit equal share in ancestral property, came as late as in 2005. So this whole problem with reforms in religion is because there is a huge outcry, essentially also because it is women's rights which are equally patriarchy is entrenched in our society, and recognizing religious reforms is also actually dealing with the ills of patriarchy, and which is not going to be easily let go. So we must understand that it has not been an easy journey. And today, as we see, when similar rights are being brought for minority communities, whether it is Muslims or Christians, there is a lot of opposition, because today it is seen as a threat to their religious identity. But this distinction that we have to maintain, that while professing and practicing religion is one thing, but where it involves your civic rights vis-a-vis marriage, divorce, property, other things, we should be able to have this distinction and not telescope one into the other.
See, one aspect, I'll be very brief on this, which is that reform necessarily includes change in the way power system is organized in any religion, group, etc. So when you're talking about reform, you're talking of dismantling power and authority structures. And those who are in power and authority are not going to take it easy. And they do everything in their thing to both subvert it, if they can't subvert it, to destroy it. So reform is at best, therefore, something which is to be very carefully thought out and thought about, rather than being pushed. And law is the last means by which reform can and should be brought about.
Though, again, I mean, I would say that some amount of law is also required, because by the time a law is brought in, because bringing a law itself requires a lot of lobbying, a lot of public opinion should be built. Then the enforcement of the law takes another decade or two, because it's all very well to have a legislation passed. For instance, property rights for women, though it has been, as far as you know, self-acquired property is concerned, the equal right to property has been there much earlier. Ancestral property came only in 2005. But in practice, the number of women who are actually having access to that is still very little, because one, because for self-acquired property, you can write a will. Very often, when you know, wills are prepared, women are excluded from the wills. Or even if women are included, women are generally not in a position to actually assert that right. They very rarely go to court against their brothers because they feel they are not eligible to it, or they don't have the wherewithal. So from building up a public opinion, a public consensus to legislation, and then actually moving to a period where we are in a position to enforce those rights, it is a long journey. And it is a constant struggle and a constant journey that all of us will have to practice, keeping in mind the goals of preamble and fundamental rights.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. The next question is from Abha again. She's asking, what constitutes threat to health as a limitation to Article 25?
So sati is very, you know, it was a religious practice where a Hindu woman is expected to die in the funeral pyre of her husband. It was essentially a practice to ensure that the property of the husband does not go to the woman or to the woman's family. So this was a practice which finally actually destroyed the life of the woman. And then you have practices like, you know, walking on fire, or, you know, I think in other countries you have genital mutilation of for women.
The FGMs, female genital mutilation. So
there are a lot of religious practices which are actually very detrimental to the health of women, children. So yes, there are
some communities where immediately after birth, the child and the mother are separated, and breast milk is not fed to the child on the ground of cultural practice. Now, here, this is where the crux comes in terms of what type of standards we do there. And therefore, there is a very concretely proved health impact because of a certain cultural practice. Obviously, that's a place where the law can intervene and should intervene.
For instance, abortion. Christianity today, or even, I mean, in many religions, abortion is not allowed, but supposing it is required for the health of the woman. So, I mean, there are any number of instances where health and religious practices actually, you know, are contradictory to each other. And these are the choices where one has to lean in favor of health. And legislation has been brought in.
Can you have the next one?
Yeah. This is a question that Sayantan and Sri Lakshmi Anand both have sent in. When people convert for socio-economic reasons, would that be a forced conversion, since it's not religion but other factors that is driving their conversion?
See, force by definition is when it is against your will. So while you may have different considerations or contexts in which you may opt for a particular religion, which is Dalits converting to Buddhism or Dalits converting to Christianity to escape the stigma of untouchability in the Hindu religion is a social context. It is a it is also a religious context, because they see the Hindu religion as being discriminatory, whereas the other religions where they are being welcomed into their fold. So no decision of an individual is taken in a vacuum. It is definitely taken in a social context. But we must also remember that when a Dalit converts into Christianity or Islam, he or she loses reservation. Which is actually detrimental to their economic interests, because then they are no longer scheduled castes, because by definition scheduled castes is recognized and untouchability is recognized only in the Hindu religion, and hence they would lose out economically, but socially and religiously they would gain. So these are all choices which people are constantly making, but whatever it is, as long as it is voluntary and it is not forced or coerced, or if as long as they are not told that you will not be able to avail of certain benefits unless you profess a particular religion, then I think people are free to convert.
Okay. The next question is about caste. Abha and Krishna Kumar both have asked it. Do people have the right to practice their caste or not? Would sub-castes claim to be minorities under Article 29 and claim protection?
Of course, they do have the right to protect their own caste practices, and people do practice their rituals. So they do have a right to do that. Would the subcaste claim to be minorities?
Unless you are able to say that
you are a denomination, yeah, and yeah. You have to be a denomination. And as we have pointed out, both in my talk and Saila's talk, to show that you are a denomination, you have to show that you are a specific identifiable group with your own cultural practice, that you have an identity well recognized separately. Unless you're able to do that, you do not get protection under Article 29. So by just being a subcaste, we do know that there are numerous subcastes in each caste, and that many people that within the same caste, there is a hierarchy, and people who are considered at the bottom part of that particular caste group may not get equal status. But that is a different thing from saying that they would have a separate denomination warranting or entitling them to protection in Article 29. Many times it has to be looked at from case to case to see whether they fit in within the protective clauses of that.
But generally, as an individual, your right is protected. I mean, nobody can prevent you from practicing that your caste or your other practices.
The issues only come to the fore when reservation benefits are concerned. In other occasions, these issues really don't become a major problem.
Or when you are seeking some institutional, like for instance, if you say that I belong to a particular subcaste and hence I am a minority and I should have the right to establish an institution. Or I have when we claim certain benefits, that's when the onus is on the community which is claiming such benefits, or certain, like the Anand Margis who are wanting to actually dance on the roads, and they claim that it is an essential part of their practice. So those are the situations where you need to establish these things. But otherwise, as an individual, definitely yes, Article 29 protects every subcaste, subsect, sub-religion in terms of practice.
Just to give an example, there are, for example, amongst the broader classification of caste considered to be called the Reddies, there are some groups who call themselves Reddies with an appellation who are Dalit communities. For example, the Konda Reddies. The Konda Reddies have SC or ST status, and many other Reddy communities get a false certificate saying that they are part of the Konda Reddies, when at all other social issues there is absolutely no relationship between these two sets of groups. So would the Konda Reddies claim that they are a separate group warranting or entitling them for protection? Yes. What about the others? Obviously, no, because they're using it only for reservation and attendant social welfare benefits given by the state. So many of these things would be able to look at it in from case to case and circumstance to circumstance.
All right. Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am. Johnny Matthew has asked the next question. Would allocation of funds for each religion by the state be a violation of the secular ethos of the constitution?
There's a bar on this.
But again, it depends upon the nature of the activity. For instance, there have been in cases where in a communal riots, certain churches and temples were destroyed. And the state gave funds to actually rebuild these churches and temples. So somebody challenged it in court saying that why should state fund the reconstruction of a temple or a church? So court said that this is not a violation, because you're essentially, the court is compensating a destruction which has happened, and this will not actually violate the the prohibition or the bar of the state practicing or helping a particular region. And so it again, like for instance, deepening of temple tanks, again they said that is a secular activity within the state. Or supposing there is a temple which is dilapidated, which is falling apart, and that particular community doesn't have. So again, it is very fact specific. It would be decided on a case to case basis whether a particular kind of funding, what kind of funding would be permitted and would not fall foul of the constitution. So it would be very fact specific.
All right, thank you, ma'am. The next question is by Kuljinder Singh. He is asking a question about the noise pollution in the name of religion. He says there are provisions, but that it is rarely followed, especially in North India. What are options available to a citizen to get rid of it? Shaila ma'am?
We had a small mishap with the...
So, noise pollution, yes, that it is a big problem with big speakers blaring all the time. And there are several options available to citizens, though there is no guarantee that you will get solutions. One is, of course, to go to the police station and complain, because it is a nuisance. Under the Indian Penal Code, if anybody causes nuisance, you can register an FIR. Then you can make a complaint to the Pollution Control Board, because under the pollution control laws, noise is also a pollution, and there are certain decibel levels which have been stipulated, beyond which it would be a violation of the notification issued by under the Environment Protection Act. So that is a complaint to the concerned Pollution Control Board is also in order. And the regular remedies are available to citizens. But there is nothing like, I think, the entire neighborhood getting together and going there and bargaining and ensuring that it doesn't happen. Ultimately, that alone works.
The answer to Mr. Kuljinder Singh is not so much of law as much as in citizen mobilization. Also, making local citizens aware that this is the law, that there is a very clear-cut law where the Supreme Court has said that it's a violation. And if you give awareness to your own local people. So when you talk the language of rights. You go to the police man, give him the copy of this thing, as also to the collector, the SP and others, and say, if you don't do this, you are going to be in contempt of the court. And you follow it up by taking up contempt action against the person, saying, going to the High Court and say, they are not following the law. I think more and more, if citizens start doing it, this will become, we will reach somewhere. And hopefully, in some years, we will be able to stop this menace of blaring loudspeakers, which are really a big nuisance. I do know a number of places in the southern states where citizen engagement has resulted in stopping of these loudspeakers used in religious institutions.
All right. Yes, thank you, sir. Thank you. Sanskriti Tyagi is asking the next question. If the unit of measuring minority being less than 50% in the state, then in states like Kerala, will Christians make part of the minority community or not?
Yeah, from what I understand, Christians constitute about 25-26% in Kerala. So it's much well below the 50% mark as per the census records. I mean, it's about 18%. The national average is 18%. Kerala's average is a little more, but it is still within the 25-26% range. So okay. Yes, it would be a constant. They would constitute a minority.
Okay. The next question is from Sri Lakshmi Anand. She's asking, can you please throw light on conversion, not merely for the sake of following a religion, but as a bigger aspect of access to education, social inclusion, employability? So she sent this through a mail, and I was wondering if we can address it right now.
We talked about this earlier. I mean, is a conversion due to coercion, or conversion due to economic reasons, or conversion due to real voluntary action on the part of the person converting? There are two, three things. Obviously, see, if somebody is converting from the religion to which they were born into, or the religion that they had generally been practicing, to a new religion, it could be in one or three or four circumstances. One is, it's completely voluntary. I have a change of heart. I see some other religion. I feel that it's attractive for a variety of reasons, including spiritual reasons, reasons of community gathering. It's a very important issue. Identity, fraternity, dignity, and these are the things which go into it. Second one is, I am forced into it. So this is the two endpoints. In between will be a series of things where you want to go to convert because you get some benefits because of the religion to which you want to convert to. Now, all of these things exist in different forms or the other. What is prohibited is force, is coercion, is something which is unacceptable in terms of pushing somebody to change involuntarily. In between is the fact that people are not getting access to things, and they find that they feel that if they convert to a particular religion, they may get access. Now, this is very true. There's no point in beating around the bush. Say you get access to, say, admission for your child in a Christian school. This happens largely in Christian institutions rather than in Islamic institutions. And so a college or a school, or you can, for example, get a job in a hospital or something like that. Now, it's very difficult because most times they have no access to any employment, etc. And this is an occasion in which they are able to get some access with the hope that they will be able to grow up in terms of the social ladder. It's a reality, and we know that it happens. It's not as great a reality as is being projected by the majoritarian groups. It may happen here and there, but it also raises the other issue. What is the community in which they were born doing when these people are feeling extremely discriminated and alienated? They don't do anything. They come running only when these people convert. So that's one part of it. The other part of it is that people do convert also, especially amongst the very poor or the marginalized communities, out of a sense of fraternity. And this is something that we have seen personally, because we've been talking to lots of these people. When they feel that, for example, when you're ill, when somebody is dying, nobody else comes. Some of these Christian groups come and spend time with you, give you the type of sense of confidence, make you feel that you're cared and that you're not alone. And these things do matter a lot in terms of the psychological well-being of the person. These are realities that we see. So is this bad? Is this something that should not be permitted? Or is this something that is happening? These things are happening. So I think we can't take a very moralistic line on these issues. Barring to say that we have to, as a society, become a lot more caring and nurturing of the unfortunate sections of our own society. When we don't do that, we have no business to talk about others who try to do it for whatever may be the purpose.
And we need not also presume that their purpose is always malefic. Yeah. Hmm. I mean, they could, you know, very well, as part of their commitment to the religion, and you know, the Christian you know, motto of service, people do go and serve. It is a fact that today, whether it is in majority of nurses, would be a lot of them would be Christian. So because the religion has a notion of service inbuilt into the whole practice of the religion.
See, so, for example, the 2015 Chennai floods, the Varda cyclone, various other disasters in the last 10 years, the most selfless service in the most dangerous of circumstances has been done by the Islamic groups. Many young Islamic community members have taken immense risk in going. I do know a number of people who have been attracted by the selflessness of these people, and the fact that they don't look into caste and community, they don't have other considerations when it comes down to lending a helping hand, which makes them want to go and spend time with them, etc., etc. So there are many factors, much more than just personal benefit, which makes people attract towards, get attracted towards other religions. And we need to acknowledge that and understand that there's a certain naturalness about the whole thing, which is based on socioeconomic reasons and practices.
Yes, absolutely, sir. Thank you. I'm tempted to connect this to another question that has come in from Amit Solanki. Do you feel that today there is a slight shift in substituting constitutional morality with religious morality?
Of course, it's happening in a very big way. It's not a small shift, it's a big shift.
Attempt for a big shift.
No, attempt has gone much more beyond attempt, particularly after 2014. It's a very big shift, and this is a very major technology change that has taken place with large sections of urban middle class professional India shifting towards a very towards a trend which causes a lot of anxiety and concern. So there is a certain religious angle to this whole change that has taken place. At the heart of it, you find that amongst large sections of Indian Hindus across the country, particularly middle class, upper class, there is a certain antipathy towards Christians and Muslims. It used to be suppressed and not very well expressed in earlier times. In the last 5 to 10 years, the political situation in the country, the type of campaigning that has been taking place, has loosened all inhibitions in people from talking about it. So there is a very clear-cut, open exhibition of anti-minority sentiments all around. It's very clear, and it's also very disturbing. You see that in the troll attacks on anybody who's talking about concern on these issues. For example, if you take lynchings, you take the whole attack on people in the name of cow protection. You take up in terms of, for example, the honor killings. The moment you write something, immediately there are lots of trolls who are attacking you and raising these issues, which is indicating of the fact that there's a very noticeable and a significant change in the thinking process of large sections of at least middle class India, which is not really falling within the broader understanding of how the constitution came. I think much of this, you'll have to trace it back also to the fact of a lowering understanding and awareness of the constitution and the constitutional parameter. For example, Nehru is being attacked as a person who, along with Gandhi, led to the partition of India. It is not Nehru. In fact, Nehru was not in favor of that. It is other people, particularly Vallabhbhai Patel also. So there are, Vallabhbhai Patel, for example, was very much against the Jan Sangh in terms of his stand vis-a-vis the RSS, particularly after the assassination of Mahatma Gandhi. Now, history is sought to be rewritten in a very clear-cut manner to create a certain mindset. That mindset goes against constitutional morality. And that mindset is something that the larger set of people who believe in the constitution will have to work on, and which is what many people, many lawyers and other constitutionally minded people have been attempting to do in this last 1 year.
Thank you, sir. Yes, I'll move on to the next question. It's by Susan Ajit. Wouldn't propagation of Hinduism as a lifestyle rather than a theocratic religion be foundationally contentious? She's asking this in the context of the Supreme Court holding that Hindutva is a quote-unquote a way of life.
Yeah, see, that ruling of Justice Verma is a very problematic ruling. Which actually, which was an issue of Hindutva being the basis of electioneering in Maharashtra, which went to the Supreme Court. That has become a tool used by the larger Hindutva groups to say that Hinduism is Hindutva and Hinduism. I mean, they sort of conflate these two things, which are actually not the same, is a way of life. And therefore, everything and everything would come under Hindutva. You may remember 4 months back, I think end of January, early February, Mohan Bhagwat, the RSS Sarsang Chalak, talked about the fact that we are 138 crore Hindus. And the denominations amongst them are Islamic and Christian. So in the RSS mind, it is very clear that we are all Hindus because we are all part of this country. And if at all people are leaving Hinduism, they have been misled. Which is why conversion of people from other communities into Hinduism is not portrayed as conversion, but as garbhapsi. See, when in politics, we have to be very conscious about the fact that politics is also a politics of terms and discourse. So garvapasi is not conversion, but conversion from Hinduism into other things is conversion. Similarly, tribal communities which have their own animistic religion, who many of whom do not consider themselves to be Hindus, are sought to be converted into Hinduism, and that's not called conversion. So we have to be very conscious about these various terms. So looked at from this context, Hinduism as a way of life has influenced the way politics in the last 20 years has been shaped. Like J.S. Varma himself, sometime before he died, was talking about the fact that perhaps he made a mistake in the way he gave that ruling. But unfortunately, that's part of the Supreme Court judgments that we have today.
All right. Thank you, sir. The next question is from Joshua Lobo. He asks a question about cow vigilantism. Can religious sentiments bar some people from their livelihoods and for some against their dietary habits by prohibiting killing of a certain animal?
This is the burning issue of the country. Yes, I mean, this is an issue that that will have to be discussed and debated. And is an issue which is very problematic. Personally speaking, beef eating has been a practice for many centuries in India. You can trace it. Actually, there are studies which say that even in Vedic times, which a lot of the majoritarian ideologues go back to, that beef eating was very much part of Brahmin and upper caste eating habits. And that the taboo on eating cow comes much, much later historically. So I think the issue of livelihoods, the issue of cultural sensibilities will have to be balanced vis-a-vis people who say that slaughtering cows upsets us in terms of our moral and ethical values. I think ultimately it is an issue which is a societal issue. Courts can at best balance out these issues. Personally speaking, I think we have to recognize that large numbers of people they have a long social and cultural practice of eating cow meat. It could be regulated, but I don't think it should be banned.
All right. So this is the last question. It's from Joshua Lobo. With regards to appointment of teachers in minority institutions, what happens when there's intersectionalities of linguistic or ethnic differences within the minority?
This essentially is left to the administration to decide on the choice of the teacher. See, you must understand that as far as appointment is concerned, the teacher, even belonging to the same minority, does not have a right of getting appointed. It is essentially for the administration to take a call. And I don't know what is the facts that they have in mind when you use the word intersectional. Because if you are saying you are both a religious and a linguistic minority, then it is essentially for the management to decide which teacher they want. They would opt for the linguistic minority teacher or for the religious minority or a teacher who satisfies both the criteria. So it is entirely left to the discretion of the management as far as appointment is concerned in a minority institution.
Aishwarya, there's a question from Johnny Matthew who says, I had asked or referred a question at 8:36 p.m. Have you asked that question?
Yeah, so has that clarified? I hope that has clarified.
Yes, ma'am. You did answer the question. I'm just trying to look for Johnny Matthew's question. Yes, I found it. the question was actually he was referring when he asked the question of allocation of certain funds for each religion, he was talking about trusts and waqf board, or he was asking based on the whether it is in Karnataka Christians, Hindus and Muslims are given funds, or under schemes religious minorities are given funds separately. Is there something like that that is against the constitution or is upholding what the constitution says?
Yeah, I think I have already clarified that when I answered that it all depends upon the nature of funding.
Yes.
Now, for instance, I mean, this is the currently, you know, the government funding Hajj pilgrims, that's been I mean, we are paying them, you know, giving them some financial assistance, which the courts have upheld as being you know, valid. So it depends upon, as long as, you know, the church is, I mean, the state is not actively conducting religious ceremonies
and promoting,
you know, particular religious ceremonies, any other secular activities are well within the constitutional limits.
All right. I think this was our last, and we're out of time also. So I would also like to tell our viewers that, sorry, there were some questions here and there that we did miss out because of shortage of time. And we hope to answer them later or bring them up in the comment section so we can continue these discussions. There were questions also regarding the Citizenship Amendment Act. And we wanted to inform the participants that we are planning to keep an entire session to discuss the CAA. Sir, do you want to say something about it for the last lecture, lecture 10?
I think we had, actually articles 5 to 11 deals with citizenship. And then, of course, the citizenship law and the amendment subsequently will also be part of it. We have deferred that to a later stage because we thought that the listeners would be more, you know, be able to understand the citizenship law as well as the subsequent amendments much better once they have the rest of the constitutional scheme in mind. So we have deferred it to a later section. So in the next four sessions, we would be, one session is going to be devoted to just the citizenship law.
All right. I'm sorry, there are some even in the live chat that are still requesting us to go back and look at questions that we missed. So I think we'll do one thing. We'll bring them up in the comment section and I'll copy paste them into the comment section. We can keep the discussion going. We can answer each other. And Shaila ma'am and Suresh sir can also put in their inputs over there. So we'll keep that discussion going. Let's not end it with this lecture. We can keep this alive.
That's a good idea.
Yeah. So the last thing I would like to tell the participants is please subscribe to the YouTube channel if you would like to be regularly updated with the lectures that are getting uploaded. You'll get a notification if you click the bell icon. So you'll get a notification when we do upload the video. And I also would invite people to write to us at kudam.center@gmail.com with feedback and suggestions in order to make this more interactive. Or if there are things that you would like us to include, issues or topics or things that you would like us to include, because we also want to keep this engagement going. So we want this to keep on getting strengthened. So we're also noticing a lot of people are going back to the lectures that were uploaded and watching them. So we are happy that that's happening. So please write to us and we look forward to hearing from you.
Good night. Good night. Until Saturday then, bye.